Dangerfield was at the peak of his career when he was approached by the Atkinson, Topeka, and Santa Fe Railway to produce tourist pictures in 1910. He was one of five artists to make an expedition to the American Southwest. And in case you're wondering which one is Dangerfield, there he is. Now, due to its remote location, the Grand Canyon remained an obscure and relatively inaccessible destination until the turn of the century. But by 1910, this large party of artists could travel with ease in their railroad car. They left from Chicago on November 5th at Ronlard in Arizona 4 days later. They were immediately transported to the El Tovar Hotel, a destination resort located on the rim of the canyon. The artists were led to Hopi Point at sunset with their eyes closed so that the vision might burst upon them for the first time in its entirety. And this account continues. This was a tremendous moment, one of the most impressive that life could hold. It was as though the earth had opened up before them and heaven was spread at their feet. So unreal, so unearthly did it seem that one feared it might burst like an iridescent bubble and vanish before one's gaze. The canyon left a profound impact on the party as no word was spoken on the homeward drive. Dangerfield in particular was moved by the vista, with sometimes silent, sometimes colorful adjectives came tumbling from his lips in a passion of appreciation. And he sprouted words which, in his moments of ecstasy, came nearer to describing the emotions of the canyon than the most finished efforts of authors and poets. And Dangerfield would channel this poetic response into paint. Over the next few days, the artist set about sketching the canyon, taking notes of the vibrant, pulsating colors that glimmered and glowed with the rays of the sun. Writer Nina Spaulding Stevens said Mr. Williams painted constantly, and his tiny sketches, one felt all the majesty of space. And Edward Pauhast, she recalled, worked with pencil and brush and took back numerous interesting sketches. Others, such as DeWitt Marshall, went quite moon mad for the canyon, preferring to focus on the subtle color transformations that occurred during the night light. And Marshall also produced some very interesting drawings of the artists on donkeys, including this self-portrait, and then one of a, I can't quite decide, either a determined or disgruntled Dangerfield. One of Dangerfield's sketches reveals his interest in value changes of the landscape, contrasting the deep charcoal black of the abyss to the light on Mars sky, and his rough lines hastily completed under the desert sun convey the canyon's sense of mystery and sublimity in its sparseness. Dangerfield's first paintings of the canyon reflected his immediate responses to the conditions of light, color, and atmosphere. In Grand Canyon number 2, the geological formation takes second tier to the looming tree in the foreground as the subject. Thick, heavy strokes give a mere impression of the site with the vital elements in hues, shadows, and light. And the Grand Canyon from the Johnson Collection, with its amorphous brushwork, captures the swiftly changing weather conditions over the rim. Similarly, Evening Glow demonstrates Dangerfield's fascination with the colors of the Southwest, casting the crevasse in these shades of pink and purple and blue. He described his method of taking in the scene through an autobiographical sketch written, again, in the third person. Quote, when he goes to the Grand Canyon, he makes his studies in a simple, student-like way that he believes is right and proper for all students to do. And when he paints his picture, it has some of the great principle which he asks us to see. In this way, Dangerfield approaches the canyon with unprejudiced eyes in order to extract the primal essence of the place. Drawing on sketches made during the 1910 visit, Dangerfield produced several paintings, including one that he called his chief work, The Grand Canyon. In comparison to his earlier studies, the Grand Canyon concentrates on the intensity of kaleidoscopic colors in the topographic striations and the atmosphere. Crimson-red plateaus are contrasted against chromatic streaks of pink, orange, and yellow. Shadows of purple and blue display the monumental depth and expanse of the site. In the upper left-hand corner, cloud cover, and tree branches to radiate transcendent light over the canvas. Dangerfield's preparatory sketch for the Grand Canyon intensifies his prismatic interpretation. Looser, chaotic brushwork with broad swashes of paint captures the artist's abstracted translation of nature's veracity. Such a work displays Dangerfield's application of Innes' technique of successive glazes and opaque layers, which produces multiple shades of color. Much like his earlier sketches, the Grand Canyon draws the viewer's attention to the expansive vista from a precarious position on the edge of the cliff. This elevated point of view, however, is more than just a visual point of sight, but it's also an ideological position. So in what art historian Albert Boyne would call the magisterial gaze, Dangerfield places the viewer with a commanding perspective, the land viewed, surveyed, and conquered. And in fact, I'm sure many of you have recreated this own gaze in your own tourist photographs, perhaps even of the Grand Canyon. There is a sense of ownership of taking a sketch or a snapshot from this vantage point, one that the tourist industry capitalized in on this advertisement from 1908 from Harper's Weekly. Now, while as an artist, Dangerfield sought to capture this great principle, we should also recall that this particular trip was commissioned by the Santa Fe Railway Company in exchange for the canvases to be used in promotional materials. As such, we should not discount the commercial nature of Dangerfield's canyon paintings of this period. In fact, the two paintings that remain in the Santa Fe Railway collection, The Divine Abyss and The Lifting Veil Grand Canyon, feature a subtler color palette, eschewing the internal spirit of nature for surface realism. And slightly as an aside, a few days ago I was taking a closer look at this photograph of Dangerfield up on the screen. He's working in his, likely his New York studio, and I realized the painting he was working on was actually The Lifting Veil. You can see them side by side there. The painting, completed in the studio rather than on site or in plein air, was a common practice for most turn of the century artists. And this photograph further enforces Dangerfield's role as an artist contractor for the Santa Fe Railway in producing images for chromolithographs or for advertisements. Of course, Dangerfield was not the only artist commissioned by the railroad. His companions, too, were supplying the company with paintings that would be used for collateral materials. Frederick Ballard Williams, Edward Pothouse, and DeWitt Marshall translated the great scenes before them into distinct points of view and paint, ranging from idealized naturalism to the impressionistic. Another member of the exhibition was Thomas Moran, who had already visited the site several times floor, including a previous trip to the Santa Fe Railway. Moran and his paintings of Western scenery captivated the American public, and his artistic output would grace the pages of guidebooks published by the railroads to promote tourism of the American West. In an advertisement featuring Moran and other eminent artists, the Santa Fe Railway encouraged Americans to become their own artists and to see the Grand Canyon with their own eyes. Moran's highly successful series of chromolithographs shaped an entire generation's understanding of its country and made the West an enduring part of the American consciousness. When we compare Moran's chasm of the Colorado to Dangerfield's The Grand Canyon, we can see the startling stylistic shifts in American landscape painting. Moran's monumental rendering of the canyon received acclaim for its astonishing coloration, fantastical rock formations, and extraordinary weather patterns. This vision of raw, unrestrained nature can only be called sublime. For many Americans on the East Coast during the 1870s, Moran's painting was their first exposure to the Western landscape. In contrast, Dangerfield's vision of sublimity results with a hyperbolic color palette and a permeating golden glow. Such a work testifies to Dangerfield's religious beliefs through the use of the divine light. While Moran's painting equally explores the awe-inspiring sublime of the nature-made landscape, Dangerfield's use of brilliant, overwhelming light coloration evokes the sanctity of the Grand Canyon. Dangerfield explored additional iterations of the sublime by incorporating figural elements into his later canyon paintings. Infinities, a 1913 canvas that's in the Johnson collection, employs the same saturated colors of the Grand Canyon, but adds a narrative component with a diminutive figure on horseback in the center of the painting. Loose brushwork conceals this figure's identity. Is this a Native American? An allegorical figure? We are unsure. In any instance, the figure appears to be undeterred by the earthly schism, standing at the edge of the precipice as he gestures towards the mountainous citadels rising above the mists in the distance. Seen from behind, the figure becomes a surrogate for the viewer to experience and contemplate the sublime and the sacred potential of nature. Yet the view the figure gestures towards is obscured by the protruding canyon wall and dense mist. This unattainable vista implies the unknown of nature and fear of the infinite. Mankind is but a moment in the expansive scheme of the universe. And such a theme recalls a much earlier landscape painting by Hudson River School artist Thomas Cole. His 1827 work, The Last of the Mohicans, depicts a similar prominent rocky foreground set against grand elevations in the distance. Cole's figures, inspired from a scene in James Fenimore Cooper's Leatherstocking Tales, are dwarfed in comparison to the natural world, suggesting the insignificance of human drama over the internal landscape. From the New England mountains to a chasm in the southwest, Infinities continues the tradition in American landscape painting to highlight the permanence of nature despite its impending progress. Dangerfield's first expedition to the American Southwest left a deep and lasting impression. So much so that in 1913, he returned to the great freak of nature, and those were his own words for the canyon, without sponsorship of the railroad or the camaraderie of his fellow artists. No longer under the obligation of commissions, Dangerfield could become more experimental in his interpretations of the Grand Canyon. The result was a number of works produced between 1913 and 1915, which demonstrate a broader visionary sweep with imaginary dream worlds and fantastical figures, all components of the symbolist movement. Originating in Europe during the late 19th century, symbolism sought to reflect an emotion or an idea rather than represent the natural world and the objective. Dangerfield's interest in revealing the internal, the emotive, and the otherworldly in his art easily corresponded with the symbolist movement. And the Grand Canyon, so foreign and strange to the Southern artist, was a fitting subject for Dangerfield's symbolist turn. For instance, the Spirit of the Storm departs from Dangerfield's previous representations of the canyon with the inclusion of a large female nude in the foreground. She leans against stacked boulders with windswept hair that visually aligns with her upraised right arm. The diaphanous pink cloth billows around her lower body, which also directs the eye to the right. She is separated from the red rocks by an abyss, and in the distance, dark storm clouds loom. The painting is dominated by a strong diagonal from the left foreground to the right background. The only counterbalancing elements are the small dark trees in the middle distance on the right. Overall, the painting is somber, but the light areas of the nude's body, the sky above her, and the brilliant reds of the canyon create highlighted focal points that help to convey a narrative. In one of Dangerfield's accounts of the Grand Canyon, he wrote, quote, "Or again, I will tell you of the vast age and somnolence of this great freak of nature, and we find carved into the rocks Titan figures of vast proportions sleeping in the midst of silence." Or if he calls the storm into being, he symbolizes the storm spirit. Envisioned in flesh, the storm raises her right arm to call forth the change in weather patterns. Her hand, delicately painted and illuminated against the blank space, contains the immense power of nature rendered in human form. As in Infinities, Dangerfield relies on the figure's turn back to transport the viewer into the scene. But by changing the scale of the figures from the miniature to the gigantic, Dangerfield alters the viewer's perception of nature. In Infinities, the viewer experiences the sublime through the spectacular perspective on the rim of the canyon. The spirit of the storm conveys that foreignness through the enlargement of the figure. Dangerfield once said, "I cannot find myself interested in what any man can see with his eyes alone." And in this way, the canyon becomes secondary to the imaginary apparition as the artist captures his internal and spiritual vision of the place. His preparatory graphite drawing for The Spirit of the Storm illustrates his academic training in the figure's dramatic curve and contrapposto stands. Dangerfield's use of preliminary sketches as progressive steps to the final painting perhaps contradicts the stance of rejecting a literary subject picture. Or it may be that the artist sought to achieve this expressive result first with pencil. Dangerfield continued his exploration with allegorical figures in The Sleepers. In this painting, Dangerfield focuses on the penumbra of the canyon, the shadowy nether region set against the soft glow in the distance. Through careful application of glazes and opaque layers with heavy black outlines, Dangerfield creates the sensation of rock titan figures emerging from the rim of the canyon. To the right, three male nudes rest, their heads slack and their faces obscured under bulging muscles. The middle figure's back emits a reddish-orange hue as if Dangerfield captured the metamorphosis between rock and flesh. To the upper left, two more nudes rest along a bluff and vegetation. Awakened from their slumber, they observe the rising sun. In the foreground, a female nude reclines with her flaxen hair undone and a loose cloth wrapped around her waist. Bathed in soft light, she is the only figure that allows the viewer to see her face. With her eyes closed and a faint smile upon her lips, she appears in a deep sleep, unaware of the viewer's gaze upon her naked form. A bright blue ripple of the Colorado River emerges in the middle of the painting before disappearing into the illusionistic background. Behind the figures in the upper left, a cliff turns into stone steps leading up to an ancient temple facade. And a classical aqueduct with distinct arches is in the middle of the painting below the sun. Strong diagonal lines of the temple steps, the blue sky, and clouds directs the viewer towards a centrally placed spherical sun. Dangerfield occasionally paired his paintings with poems, adding an oral dimension to experiencing the work. He wrote this one, "Age on age the sleepers rest, to see in dreams the canyon splendor rise, height on height from riverbed to golden crest. Gods are they as you and I, who see in spirit with eyes deny." These slumbering giants have obtained the spiritual vision Dangerfield so sought after in his paintings. And the descriptive lines suggest viewing the intangible spiritual plane beyond the surface realities of the Grand Canyon. This site is no mere chasm in the earth, but a bygone city, an American acropolis built from the imagination of ancient bedrock. Now we return to the opening image, Dangerfield's visionary, the genius of the canyon. Dangerfield described the painting in his autobiography, once again written in the third person. Quote, "He painted the canyon from several points of view, but this composition is an expression of the emotion it awakened in him, and it is purely imaginative. A woman's figure symbolizing silence is resting on a great cliff. Her head is bent in a brooding calm. A strip of crimson drapery streams over the gray sides of the cliff, and in the distance, minarets and a dome lie under the sunlight, their jeweled color gleaming with splendor." The description emphasizes Dangerfield's conceptual approach to visualizing the canyon with an allegorical figure and an exotic city. Like The Sleepers, Dangerfield also composed a poem for the Grand Canyon, one that paralleled the painting's composition. "Stripped from the earth her crust, and we see revealed the carving glory of the inner world, temple, domed, silent, while the genius of the canyon broods, nor counts the ages of mankind, a thought amid an everlasting calm." Indeed, Dangerfield presents an internal perspective of a sacred place, and once again, he reminds viewers that nature, by extension the divine, is infinite in span compared to man's limited time in corporeal form. The genius of the canyon, we can, in the genius of the canyon, We can see Daintfield's expression of the great principle he so sought after in his paintings. And this work garnered great acclaim in Daintfield's lifetime, selling in 1907 for a considerable sum, $50,000, which was one of the highest prices paid for a living artist at that time. And critics largely judged the work to be among Daintfield's best. However, there's always one. One reviewer found the new figure less than satisfactory, declaring, quote, "The genius of the canyon is not particularly good, but the rest of the picture is delightful." Now, such a comment goes to show that not all viewers appreciated Daintfield's rejection of traditional attitudes towards landscape painting. While Daintfield's reputation gained a national stature due to his Grand Canyon work, the South was a constant place of inspiration during his final period of his career. Upon his return to Blowing Rock, North Carolina, after his second trip out west, he built a home and a studio, Westlow. The classical revival building with its large white columns and a pediment evoked the style of houses he recalled from his childhood, including the structure that burned down during the Civil War. Perhaps, then, Westlow was Daintfield's monument to his Southern roots and a testament to the potential of the Southern landscape. By building Westwood, Daintfield was following in the tradition of other American landscape painters, such as Frederick Edwin Church with Olana, Thomas Cole at Cedar Grove, and Albert Bierstadt's Mount Caston, in creating his own private environment. An aesthetically pleasing studio surrounded by a pristine wilderness signaled to the American public the status and the achievement of the artist. From the comforts of his Westlow studio, Daintfield continued the bold personal explorations and experiments in color, light, and mood that he'd begun out west. Two paintings in particular illustrate Daintfield's southern manifestation of his western foray, Sunset Glory and Carolina Sunlight. In the former, Sunset Glory, the dense vegetation and a solitary tree dominates the foreground while the mountain range is silhouetted in blue against a chromatic sky. The emphasis on the colorful sky could be a southern response to the dramatic sunsets he saw out in the Arizona desert. And in Carolina Sunlight, evidence of human presence from a derelict cabin, broken cart, and a small figure are dwarfed by the impressive scale of nature, revisits the theme he expressed when painting the Grand Canyon. In both instances, Daintfield suppresses the details of a specific locale through soft, loose brushwork in order to heighten the introspective and poetic mood of the landscape. From the Great Chasm to the west, the misty peaks of the Blue Ridge Mountains, Daintfield found a similar responsive chord in the natural environment. The spiritual aura at both locations aided the artist in his quest for an intimate aesthetic beyond the veil of reality. In so doing, Daintfield developed some of his most imaginative and visionary work, testing the boundaries of what landscape paintings could look like and how art could act as a conduit for the divine.